And action.
Hey guys, what's up? It's Sick Folks of Cinema. This week I'm going to be your host. My name is Dina, and as always, we've got the lovely Heather Rogue.
Lovely-ish.
Oh, me.
Yes, you. And then we also have Stefan Bowman. And of course, what would a podcast be without Keith Graber?
This guy. Wait, you didn't say lovely. All right.
Oh, you're lovely. You know you're lovely. All right. Well, let's just jump right into it. What have you guys been watching this week?
I'll go first.
Do it,
Heather,
lovely.
You go first.
Okay.
What have you been watching, girl?
So I got to talk about this. I watched The Haunting of Bly Manor on Netflix.
Ooh.
The sequel to Haunting of Hill House.
Mm-hmm.
So, which was if you excellent. Were a big fan of Haunting of Hill House, like my friend Keith over there just gave me the thumbs up indicating that he was, if I couldn't read facial expressions, then you might like Haunting of Bly Manor. You might. The thing is, I love it, and I also freaking have major issues with it that kind of basically ruined the show for me by the end, killed all of the tension.
They
killed the tension early, and they have like a really scary premise going on this time around, and I'm super into it. And like in the beginning, I'm like, yes, I found a show I can binge right now. This is gonna be great. I am so stoked for all of the spooky faces and figures going on in the background of shots, and to look for all of the scary stuff and like this intriguing mystery with these dolls and shit like that, and this little girl who will like stare at you like she's looking behind you, and like it's so freaking creepy. And then you know how ghost stories do this thing where like the suspense is based off of revealing information, right? You know, and
yeah.
It's like how you maintain attention. And they were trying to do that for 9 episodes, right? So they kept trying to like
9
add more shit. It's a 9 episode series, right? So
mm-hmm.
And they kept adding more shit, and they couldn't maintain that tension. They were redoing jump scares without including new information. Like it lost me. It wasn't scary. The other thing is they pulled the punches. At the end of the day, they were afraid to hurt the characters. Like they'll kill them, but they won't like hurt their souls in the way that the premise was building up to. And you know, and then the other thing is the basic most essential failure of the show was a failure of show don't tell, because they spend so much time talking and there's these monologues that feel like they're building up to actual experiences that the characters are gonna suffer through, but then they actually end up just building up to another monologue later, you know?
Oh no.
And so like, yeah, the actors carry this movie, they deliver their lines to perfection, and it's great to just watch them do it. But at the end of the day, you know, I really liked the metaphors, and I felt like almost like I wish that they could have just like developed them a bit more. Like it's cool to be like, oh, this is a metaphor, but then it's like they didn't have time to explore because they layered so many different metaphors on top, you know? And it's like they only had time to be like, hey, I'm a metaphor, before they had to move on to a new metaphor, and before they allowed that to like make a point about the truth of human nature beneath identity, like they were kind of leading into with this dementia metaphor, or like about how to navigate a potentially abusive relationships, like they were leading into with this possession metaphor, but they didn't deliver at the end of the day, you know? And so it's mm-hmm. like it's been boggling my mind what I hate, what I don't like about this show, because all the pieces were there, the execution just wasn't there, you know what I mean? So that's all I want to talk about. If you liked Haunting on Hill House and for the drama and not for the scariness, then you might like binging Bly Manor.
Ooh, so it's worse than I thought, Heather.
it's more of what you didn't like about Hill House.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I didn't like the drama, the silliness, and I feel like Hill House had failed executions too, and they sort of like became their own worst enemy. They ruined what they set up, you know, in a lot of
I've seen that a lot, especially with horror television. You see it a lot where in a movie you know that the suspension is going to drop, you know that there's going to be a drop where you're like, and there's going to be a reveal. But when it's episodic, I feel like sometimes creators feel like, okay, we have to keep it up. We have to keep up the tension. It's like they're edging. And it's like, you don't have to do this. Just let it happen. Like, that's, you know, scary enough. And then continue the story. So I haven't seen either one yet, but I really wanted to watch either one.
Oftentimes, I find in series, I often find that they're less willing to go there than in horror movies. You know, like some of the movies that we've reviewed are really for sick fucks, and don't often see a series say, yeah, let's go there. I guess maybe for fear of losing audience. I don't know.
But to me, because it's like a horror movie at its core is a tragedy, and you need to see the characters suffer and get hurt, because that's like how you experience the catharsis of tragedy. And it's like a weird thing, but it's real. And when you try and set up a horror, but you don't actually have your characters experience the horrific thing, like they're kind of like saved from it in some way, then it's a long tragedy. And why is it even a horror movie at that point? It's a comedy, you know, just without jokes.
But imagine something like a Hill House, the next series, touching on anything close to like the loved ones, the torture scenes in that, or anything. Like, it just doesn't happen. You don't normally see something like that. It's weird.
Yeah, well,
you don't normally see it, but then again, like, that's why I liked Us. Or was it Us? No, it was You, right? Isn't that the one, the stalker show?
You is great.
Yeah. That's why I liked You, was because they went there and I was like, oh shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I get very hesitant about a lot of streaming or TV horror stuff. And not just because I'm a huge fan of like Blood and Guts, but because a lot of my friends who watch, you know, the different things, I never really hear any good stuff. I never hear, man, that one episode, bro, you got to watch it.
So I will say that there are episodes of You, like the mushroom scene is, or whatever, when he's tripping. That's such an amazing episode. It really had me on the edge of my seat. That was really, really good. And it is like that with True Detective and with Devs and with all of these other series that are dark and that I really, really like. There's usually only like one or two episodes that like really fucking nailed it, and it's never the last one, you know what I mean? It's like the second one.
What about you, Stefan? What you been watching with your time machine?
Hold on, we're gonna go back to the future,
guys. We'll put a spreadsheet up in the chat for spreadsheet.
Oh my lord. Let's see here. I started Magician season 5 on Netflix. Got to like 2 episodes, didn't get too far. I did WandaVision episode 1 and 2. Nice. I like certain aspects of it, but I really hope it gets fucking better, man. Because if it's only what 6 or 7 episodes and it's all like the 2 episodes I've already watched, I don't know what audience they're really looking for with it. Granted, I do love black and white stuff. I really do. Does feel like a little rip off of Pleasantville, though. If you've ever seen Pleasantville, what was it with
The one with Tobey Maguire.
Yeah, Tobey Maguire.
It was Reese Witherspoon.
Yeah,
right?
Then they go inside the TV, and then once emotions hit, then color starts to come about, and they rip off that hard as shit. I watched Warrior season 2. And for those who haven't seen that, that's basically based off of short stories by Bruce Lee. And Bruce Lee's daughter, Shannon Lee, is one of the major producers with some other people. And they took, you know, one of his short stories and turned it into a TV show. And it deals with the hatred and, you know, really crazy shit that happened around that time when, you know, Chinese were coming here and, you know, Chinatown and early history in Frisco. And it's gory as shit, man. If you really, it's really gory. It's really dark. A lot of sex and drugs. And then I got through Snowpiercer season 1, which is based off the film. And that has Jennifer Connelly. And it was actually pretty good. Apparently HBO Max put on some shows that are from Cinemax, Sci-Fi, and some other channels. I don't know if they own those channels because I never heard of them owning them. But maybe they do.
Yeah, if you go on HBO Max, it's really weird because they have some, like, they have everything that Adult Swim's ever done. Like, the shit that they have on HBO Max is weird. Like, you could tell it's not just HBO. They just kind of all right, you can't access this anywhere else. We'll throw it on HBO Max. Yeah, no, yeah, you know?
They own, I believe they own that stuff. That stuff they own, but I wasn't aware about the whole Cinemax thing. HBO, that kind of threw me for a loop.
Who's HBO owned by? Aren't they owned by?
It's AT&T. It's AT&T.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, they own it. Yeah.
I was going to say
Viacom. And AT&T Media is known as Warner Media. They're the ones that didn't let all the actors know and directors and producers when they were putting all those movies on HBO Max throughout this year. Yeah, yeah, they're the ones that didn't communicate with them. And then the last thing is I didn't have HBO for the longest time. I finished Game of Thrones season 8 finally.
Ooh.
Congratulations. Now you're disappointed like the rest of us.
Quite the opposite for me, though. I think because I had such a break from the show. I'm not saying that I loved it 110%, but I'm trying to, when I watched it, I was thinking of other paths they could have took. And I don't know. I personally, spoiler alert, I like what they did with the Mother of Dragons, but I can see where a lot of people like my wife wouldn't have.
They just needed to do it differently. Like we were coming about a second ago, it was all execution was the issue. There was a couple of structural errors. Like I feel like that issue should have been resolved before the White Walker issue to like make the climax kind of match a little bit better.
They needed those dragons with the White Walkers, man.
There was a whole way that everything could have been rearranged in order to like make it more believable that Daenerys was like actually, because they, what did they do? They like, they killed Missandei and she could have gone ballistic right then and there and it would have made sense right after killing Missandei. But then they wait until like another episode until all of the other conflicts are resolved, until she's victorious and has won. And then she's like, well, now I'm going to kill you all anyways. And it comes out of left field at that point. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I kind of wish the Mad Queen would have snapped right then and there, and you really saw what she can do and the cruelty that she could do. And I was like, it was just so, the way that they did it, the way that they killed her, the way that Cersei died, I was like, what the fuck is this shit? Because I was pissed. I wanted her brother to be the one that killed her and then went back to his night woman. I was like, what the fuck?
Yeah, I don't think he was going to kill her because she was pregnant with another of his children. So,
guys, can I admit something to you?
He's never watched Game of Thrones.
100% a Game of Thrones virgin. I've never. I was relating more to the dog that was barking in Heather's background than what you guys were saying.
You know what? Can I make a confession too? I've never seen Breaking Bad.
Oh, you're not alone.
So everybody's got that show, which is actually on my list.
No, I'm in that.
It's on there.
I've never seen.
I tried watching. Never seen which one, Heather?
Sopranos.
I've seen most of it. I haven't seen all of it, but I've seen most of it.
I remember watching it when it was on like HBO, catching it here and there. Keith, what have you been watching?
Okay, so I've been watching this one show. You guys might have seen it on Netflix. It's The History of Curse Words with crazy ass Nicholas Cage hosting.
That shit's so goddamn fucking funny.
And yeah, so I watched the whole first season. It's honestly a little more cute than I thought it would be. It's a little more like something you'd see on VH1, you know, if it was on cable.
Why I liked it.
Yeah, all the celebrity guests that they go to for the discussions and stuff like that. And then, you know, Nicolas Cage is, I guess maybe his publicist was there, so he wasn't as crazy as I was hoping him to be. You know what I mean? It wasn't like, he was very subdued and very like directed, and it was, I don't know. Can I tell you something weird? That it actually, as silly as it was, it kind of depressed me, some of the episodes, especially like the one, they did one about the word damn, and it just, I just knowing how many years of silly censorship we've put ourselves through as a species is ridiculous and depressing to me. To know that, like, I mean, imagine an alien lands and they're like, what's a curse word? And it's like, it's a word that we made up so that we can't say it. The fucking stupidest thing I've ever heard of. Like, why would you do that? You imagine if an alien landed and said, yeah, don't say that. We made it up and now we can't say it anymore. It's bad to say it. Why'd you make it up? I don't know. It just, you can say, that's cool. It means the same thing though. What the fuck is wrong with you? That's what a stupid species does, is worry about no-no words.
Yep.
Meanwhile, the best people was... are dying, people are hungry, we're all poor, we're all fighting, the earth is dying. We're worried about no-no words? I want to punch somebody.
Yeah. The best example of censorship in that show was the dick episode. And I don't remember who pointed it out, which comedian did, but they said the best example of censoring dick is a Patton Oswalt joke. Because if you say like, oh, my dick is being a dick, it'll sound like my bleep is being a dick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So yeah. You can't it'll get bleeped out if it's referencing the body part, but if it's like, oh, you know, you're just being a dick, they won't censor it on TV. And it was like, yeah,
I was
that was a good one.
I was also personally annoyed with the bitch episode, because they, you know, and I'm not like griping about social justice and all that stuff, I feel like it was, they didn't even touch on, you know, all these different interpretations of the word for bitch. Is it always went immediately to misogyny, and what I've always known as a bitch, and they've never like defined the word as this, was, okay, if you're a complete cruel and mean person, and if you're a male, I would call you a dick. If you're a female, I would call you a bitch. And maybe it's because I grew up in Catholic school, these motherfuckers never had nuns. Like, it had nothing to do with misogyny. These cruel motherfuckers would beat you, and they're evil. You could, like, Ronnie has some great stand-up about getting his ass handed to him by a nun. She literally, I think, told him, I hate you, and you're a piece of shit, and, like, you're the worst student I've ever had. And, like, you don't say that to a kid. That's where, like, to me, that's what the true meaning of that is, just a cruel person.
Mm-hmm. Who happens- if it's a woman, but then if it's a man, bitch means that you're more like a woman.
Yeah.
So
there's other interpretations.
It's misogynist.
There's many other meanings. And honestly, when you use the word bitch to somebody who's not being cruel, but actually just being assertive of themselves, that's misogynistic. But the true meaning behind it, like when people say that life's a bitch, no one's saying like life's a pussy or life's like some woman who should just shut up. Life is being cruel to you. And, you know, in this whatever silly context, we're making it a female, like it's a ship or something. I don't know. But I wanted to jump in and be like, hey guys, what about this one other meaning of the word? You know, like
the one thing I took out of that episode is that I identify as a bitch goddess and take that to the bank. Those are my pronouns.
I say everyone should run with all their insults. Like, do it, you know.
I hear what you're saying, Keith. There's
well,
people
when you do that, you can bring power to, like, when women say, like, I'm a bad bitch, like, you know, I'm that bitch. It brings power to it. It's reclaiming that, you know? And there was another episode where, there was another curse word where they took that and it was shit. It was shit.
Yeah,
so the episode of, yeah, when they were like, I'm the shit, and that meant you were the, you know, you were the shit. And so they turned that curse word and they just like flipped it. It's one of those things where it's like you take a word that's so demeaning and so censored and just like a negative word, and you turn it into a positive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I find it interesting how, you know, as humans we manipulate things. You know, it's when you're saying, you know, like how you were saying, you know, life's a bitch, right? And what it means and how people twisted it to manipulate it to make it mean something else when that's not what it means at all. I just find that very, very convenient and interesting.
No, well, you know? I think that the meaning of that phrase still holds true, but the meaning of that phrase was a little bit overlooked in everyone's interpretation of the word bitch in that episode. That's all I'm saying.
So I think that it's still inherently misogynist, but not every single use of it is. So life's a bitch is not a misogynistic use of that. But I think the origin of the word is misogynist.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would agree with that. The other thing I was watching, and this is weird, I don't want to do any spoiling of anything here. So I'll tiptoe around this. But like, okay, so I have this thing that I deal with, I guess you would call it synchronicity, where, you know, I do like just little things stack up in my life. And if I would explain it to you, you'd be like, oh, that's just,
you know, I love a good synchronicity. You know, I love a good synchronicity. Yeah. Keith.
And I'd be like, oh no, the first 17 were coincidences. The next 367 mm-hmm. were fucking weird. At this point, we're dealing with full on synchronicity. Okay. Mm-hmm. But I watched The Midnight Sky.
I was asleep to that
last night.
If anyone's seen it, I don't want to spoil the ending, but oh my god, it's a similar theme to the movie that we are reviewing. And I was like, really, this happened twice in 1 week? I watched two movies with the same ending. And then
that's the George Clooney one, right, on Netflix? Yeah.
And the other thing that annoyed me about that movie is it was okay, it was good, it's just a little like,
that's not
little,
bad
a little
Netflix schmuck,
you know.
I fell asleep sleep to it,
but they, so they have a really good ending, like a solid, you know, a twist, a fun, you know, like, wow, okay, this is moving. And then they undermine it immediately by doing like that Bob's Burgers working over the credits bullshit at the end. And I was swinging at the TV. I was pissed.
It was flipping tables.
You just moved me with emotion, and now you're Bob's Burgering me with these people.
Oh,
like,
they cheapened it. They cheapened it for
are
you.
Those basically credits coming out the screen? Well, I guess we just get to work, you know. Oh. Anyway,
oh my god.
So they cheapened the experience with the after credits. Yeah, okay. Yeah, that happens a lot lately. Yeah.
That'll happen. Well, I'll tell you guys what I've been watching. I'm still with Ed on his American Horror Story journey. We finished Asylum this week, mm-hmm. which we're going through. What I found is I let him usually pick, but so far he's picked the ones that are like my least favorite. So we're getting those out of the way. Like, we watched Asylum and then we just started Murder House, which, I mean, we stayed up till 3 a.m. last night watching Murder House. That's season one.
Yeah,
and
Keith looks confused.
Yeah. And so, like, we're getting there on the American Horror Story journey. And we also watched the movie this week, Goodnight, Mommy.
Mm-hmm.
So let's get into that review.
Quick question,
shall we?
Though. What did Ed think of his American Horror Story that you showed him?
Well, I asked him which one was his favorite, and he hasn't decided yet.
Okay.
He wants to. I think what he's gonna do is he's gonna watch all of them and then tell me which ones are his favorite. I think he's saving it to, like, I don't want to tell you which one because then it won't be my favorite anymore. I don't know, but I asked him and he was like, listen, I'm watching it, I'm dissecting it, this is not the time for questions. And I'm like, okay, we're taking this real seriously.
Nice.
Like, by he way, just Stephen. Now noticed that they just recycle all the actors. He's like, wait, do they just use all the same actors? I'm like, yes, you've watched like five of them now.
Nice reverse segue, Stephen.
Oh, I was just curious when she said it, how she said it. I was,
hey,
like, oh,
remember
shit,
that
I gotta
thing
know
we were talking
answers.
About earlier in the pod. Okay.
Okay. So
back to the haunted blind manor.
For all the people out there who don't know what Goodnight, Mommy is, this is a German film about two twin boys who do everything together, from collecting beetles to feeding stray cats, welcome their mother home after her reconstructive surgery. But with their face wrapped in bandages and her demeanor distant, they grow suspicious of her identity.
They don't think it's the real mom. The
reason is
her face is different, but also because she's acting different. She's not acting like their mom anymore.
Yeah, she's acting like a total bitch.
She's acting like a And the cops came and they were like, what's going on? And she's like, you know, it's just been really hard since the accident and the separation, right? So she's like going through some shit. So you're not really sure what, like, I was not really sure what, whether she was really their mom or not. And like, it wasn't really until the end that, and I was, even then I was still kind of puzzling it out for days on end, but like, yeah, it wasn't really until then that you start to realize what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this movie was okay. I'm gonna say something controversial. So for as boring as it was a mind fuck throughout the entire thing. Mm-hmm. Like, I felt like I was being like waterboarded in the most boring way possible.
Waterboarded.
Because it just, for me, it was so slow during the whole thing.
Waterboarded.
And then it wasn't until they like
with a water pistol.
Yeah. And it wasn't until like the end that I was like, oh shit, this is picking up. Okay. It's happening. Things are happening. But it literally like 20 minutes to the end, I was like, okay, now things are happening. And it made me go back as I was watching it. I was like, okay, recapping like what was happening in the beginning. But it was really slow for me. I don't know.
Yeah.
I found it slow, but I found that I was really intrigued by it. So it was easy to watch regardless of the pacing for me, because of the fact that you want to figure out what's going on. And so you're paying attention in order to solve the mystery. And then it hooks you, and then it drags you through, and it drags you kind of round around a merry-go-round too, during certain parts where it's like, it's not like the story is having trouble moving forward to the next part. You know what I mean? And it's like struggling, to develop this conflict in it, you know, like it doesn't know how to develop the conflict. It seems like it's searching to figure out how it's going to escalate things, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Like I felt like it was unsure of how, or even, well, okay, I won't say what the climax would be of. It was unsure of how the climax would happen. Like, how are they going to set the stage? It's like they set it up and they were like, nope, nope, nope. We're going to go ahead and erase. We're going to start all over. Nope. Let's go ahead and start one more time. You know? I felt like they were unsure.
I had pretty strong issue with the pacing in this film. First of all, I will say that I respected it. I respected it more than I liked it. I respect it. Like,
yeah,
it was definitely compelling. And for the most part, and you could tell, like, I think the problem was it was like a little too self-aware. Like, it was going for indie awards. It was like, hey, here's some shots of meaningless shit, you know, like, and then we're left to question what the meaning is in that. And there was just a little too much of that and not enough meat on the bone in terms of delivering the horror, for my taste. I will say it gets a booby award. There were boobies.
There were boobies.
So delectable, those boobies.
Yeah, but
those boobies, know, bad. You're bad boobies.
And Heather loves boobies, but what I love, these are my boobies. No, not really, but like when there's natural elements, when there's a lot of natural scenery and cinematography.
Natural boobs?
Should turn.
Yeah, the cinematography was beautiful in this.
Yeah.
Like, Germany is such a weird country. Like, there were so many things where I was like, what? Oh, yeah, this takes place in Germany.
What was like, it? Austria, there, or was like, it Germany?
Was it Austria or Germany?
Oh, it was Austria, right? Was Austria. Or someone was Austrian, right? Like, yeah. I think they said their mom was Austrian.
It was maybe like a border thing. Like, but I think.
Maybe.
Yeah, technically.
But there were some parts that tripped me out. Like in the beginning when they were walking on the ground and it was almost like spongy. I was like, what ground, is that? Yeah. Yeah, like the squishy ground. I was like, what is that? Even Ed was like, I don't know what
I've
that
seen
is.
That before,
there was like, that.
TikTok is that like a bog?
Doing that.
Is that like a bog?
Yeah, like the water seeps under the grass or something like that. But
yeah.
I don't know. And I was surprised to see cornfields in Austria. I was like, they have
they like the corn. Yeah. No, I liked the filmography or the cinematography. I was gonna say filmography. I liked the cinematography. Acting was on point. I really liked the house. The house was a nice house, man.
that was a gorgeous
you
house.
A shitty heart.
Sell it to me.
House. Yeah.
I could live in there. I could.
Loved the kids' wallpaper. Like, you can see it in Stefan's background right now, but the just ants? The ants crawling on the wall. I was like, oh, that's super funky and cute. Like, I would have the
that
wallpaper.
Could also
like
have
that.
Symbolism,
cool.
Right? It could also have symbolism. Like, when I saw that, it started making me think to maybe something that what maybe they weren't even trying to do, but it made my mind kind of think that way. Like, for me, like, when something's dead or festering, the insects eat at it, right? And so maybe these children, spoiler alert, or child, is, you know, whatever had happened, it's festering and it's eating him, right? And so he's slowly losing his sanity, if you will, right? And the thing that got me, I say, well, out of the like three things that got me, the one thing that got me the most too is, right, she came home having some form of plastic surgery. Now, was that like a voluntary thing to improve the way she looked? Maybe not. Did she get in a car accident? Don't know. Didn't see a car there. They didn't really reference anything as far as a car accident, as far as I can remember. And then when she said they got separated, then it caused another thought in my head. Did she have to get reconstruction surgery because her husband beat the shit out of her? And that's why he's not in the house, or you don't see him at all. Mm-hmm. Possible. Maybe.
That's
I don't know.
Something that the film did in a lot of different ways, which is why I got a lot out of watching it like last week and letting it fester inside of me this whole week, is because of the fact that it had me going through all of those different things in order to figure out the hell happened, what's going on. Like, it got under my skin. Part of it is, since we're already in spoiler territory and you revealed the big twist, but part of it is the fact that it doesn't have a straightforward ending. Like, the ending,
yeah,
the ending is straight subtext. And so when a story does this, like Annihilation did this, and other movies do this, where, like, you know, people try and interpret the ending of Annihilation based off of the text of the story, but you can't anymore because the subtext has become the text at that point. Like, the actual metaphors that they're talking about has become the overt, like, actual storytelling thing going on. And that's what happened here, where it's like the ending is so vague, it's no longer a concrete story where you can put a pin on it and be like, this is what happened. It leaves it so open to interpretation that then it gets under your skin and lingers there for days on end.
Well, what exactly are you referring to when you say the ending, Heather, for that? Because I felt like the ending, I mean, you, like the very end, like when it was like Star Wars.
I'm talking about when she got burned in the house, when the house burned down, and then he leaves, and then they're holding hands and singing.
Like the Jedi, you know what I mean? It's like Yoda and Obi-Wan are reunited and they're all friends again.
Well, the Force Ghost? You're talking about the Force Ghost?
Exactly. Yeah, the Force Ghost bullshit. Yeah.
Which to me is clearly a hallucination or whatever. Like, it's clearly not really real, because his mom wasn't actually sitting there waiting at the end of the cornfield, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but whose perspective is the hallucination? Like, who's hallucinating that?
Definitely the boy, for damn sure.
Well, even a hallucination, because this is what I'm saying, at that point the subtext is the text, so it's not, we're not even in a movie anymore at that point, is what, right. We're not even in the story, we're dealing directly with the theme.
I saw that and I didn't give him as much credit. I just saw that and I was like, okay, this is dumb.
It was very vague. It was almost vague, but it also just wasn't vague enough. You know what I mean?
Ham-fisted, like, vagueness is what it was.
It was exactly. It was cheesy, really.
Yeah.
That could have been executed slightly better. There is a strange thing, and I don't know if you guys caught it, but when you see the house burning and you see the fire trucks, you literally see his mom run past the fire trucks. Like, if you don't look for it, you will not see it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really bad to rewind. And I was like, what the, who's that?
So if she wasn't a ghost, that you know, arguably couldn't have been possible, etc. So
yeah,
I think that's what we got at the end. We got the reunited Force ghosts at the end.
To me, that's not what gets me. To me, what got me was I was trying to figure out if his brother was, like, it seemed imaginary at the end there. And
yeah.
And that was like one of those things where I'm still trying to figure out if the mom is real or not too. Like, I'm still trying to figure out what's going on. And like the reveal happened so subtly where it's like, if I don't remember the other kid's name, but the real kid is asking, is saying like, if you knew what he was doing right now, like the, or he says like our mom, our real mom would know what he was doing right now.
Elias is the living and Lucas is the dead.
Yeah.
And she's like, I can't see him. And he's like, it doesn't matter. If you were really our mom, you'd know what he was doing anyways. And it was like, the once he puts that impossible trap down for it, where there's like no win for her, no way for her to ever prove that, you know, it was something that the story was playing with, but it ends up confirmed right there in that moment. And that's when it kind of clicks for me that this is clearly... That's when, like, I finally know what's going on, was that curtain burning
moment. And that's one of those things where the mom should have nipped it in the bud in the beginning. Like, he's already seeing his dead brother, spoiler alert, and talking to him, interacting with him. And then because of circumstances, you know, instead of nipping it in the bud right away, right, she allows it to continue.
Yeah.
And it only festers and grows worse, you know.
Well, also, I mean, I know, I was shaking my head a lot with the fact that this grown adult couldn't get out of, being tied up by a child.
Oh, the gauze and tape?
It was like the worst, you know, version of Peter Pan I ever saw or something. It was just like, what is happening here? This
child, you could. It was like Home Alone, but
yeah.
Really dark, you know?
And guys, you know how big of a fan I am of torture porn. The fact that that was
that you call it that shows us.
Well, the fact I don't like it. I'm calling it that because you guys get off on it because you're like, oh yeah, oh.
I just call it horror.
Because you call it torture porn. It's like, you all know what my opinion is of transgenders, right? Well, yeah, you called it that, so I know what your opinion is. Like,
but I will. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
No, I just wanted to say, like, the keep in mind that was the bulk of the sort of the horror that we got was, oh, somebody's being tied up and tortured. Just so you know, that's the scary part right here. You know, and yeah. That lost points in my mind as well. So sorry, Stephanie.
Mm. No, I was just going to say that other than the cinematography, you know, obviously pacing needed a little work. Editing wasn't bad. Could it have been shorter? Definitely. It could have been 15 to 20 minutes shorter, honestly. The thing that I will say, though, they did put a little bit of money in the practical gore effects. In the part when they're cutting the glue loose from her lips.
That was probably the moment where I was like, oh, okay, this is happening. This is all right. So I know I talked a little shit about there being not much going on, but that's enough for me.
That was
not on board.
The sick fuck moment of the movie.
Definitely. Oh, definitely. Oh man,
that's what makes it for grown-ups only.
Well, that and when she's not paying attention, which might, you know, 50-50 could happen to anybody. When she tries to run outside, spoiler alert, to escape, and then she hits that wire.
Boom. Home Alone.
I don't know if you guys, if you noticed, she hit her head so hard that it triggered a Tubi ad break. it was like, that must be, I imagine that's what she was dreaming of. Like, you know how on cartoons there's stars going around their head? On Tubi, you just see like ads for Toyotas and stuff. So. Tubi, you got to time your ad breaks better. I'm sorry, that one pissed me. I had to rewind and I'm like, wait,
that's such a good ad break.
I know, I was like, okay, she's going down, what's gonna happen next? And then you come back from the ad and we're in spoiler territory, so yeah. Spoiler alert. You come back and like one of her eyes is super glued shut, the other one is kind of, and then like they're wearing the masks. Like it turned into a religious experience at that point. Like religion had a lot to do with it. And I was unsure of the religious aspect of it, but I don't know. I think the kids were just
this
religious.
This kid was like trying like, to do the stop the steal thing. This was a QAnon. Yeah.
Yeah, that was the Kyushaman right there 12 years earlier.
I really liked what they did with the cat, too. That was crazy.
That was one thing that was vague that they didn't answer is, okay, so did the mom kill the cat? Did the cat not eat and die?
Probably died because it was
already. Or did the kid kill the cat and then not remember because he doesn't believe it was him? He believes it was his brother.
I grew up going to the woods a lot, and we would rescue sick animals. I can't tell you how many times I rescued a sick animal, and every single time it died in your care. So that's my first assumption was.
Yeah, that it died on its own.
I've never rescued a sick animal and been like, and then it's still, you know what I mean? It's like that lion that comes back. What was that lion that came back and didn't eat the guy? And you're like, oh, there's a huggy. it was like the world's first meme or something. It was just like circulating the globe for, I don't know, 20 years.
Yeah. And the thing that got me too, that they surprised me a little bit, was when they went into the, I guess that would be the equivalent of a basement, or maybe that was the basement, and they're looking for the cat, right? And I see they put the freezer in the shot, and right there I was like, okay, that cat's in the fucking freezer, dude.
Yeah, that's what I thought too. Like
TV cat dinners.
Like, yeah.
Yeah. And then it wasn't.
That was strange too. Like she bought them like a year's supply of just frozen food, and she was just like, it was like she had given up at that point. She was just like, "Fuck it, we're gonna sell the house."
You know, and that's the thing.
Y'all
is
are
she having
come with the house? Yeah. They've got food already.
Is that?
Like, it was a very weird.
I think it was because she was having a midlife crisis because she lost. And see, that's the other thing that's kind of vague too. Okay, we got that they separated. We got that there was an accident, which is possibly why her face got that way. And then the way she's talking to the son, it sounds like the brother died in the accident, which therefore, however long this was going on, triggered him to have an imaginary best friend that was his brother. How long ago did this accident happen prior to the plastic surgery? And, you know, not even just what accident, but did the father, did she just say they separated to maybe make it more a little bit easier on him because he died in the accident too, possibly?
I don't know. And
maybe. I don't know. Like it was very, the mom was very like, she threw me for a loop. She really did, because even when they were playing the game of like, 21 questions, and she was the answer. And she was like, who do I know that has two sons? Who do I know? Yeah, wait, do like I that. Know this person that has two sons?
Plus like, she's slapping something like, on her head right after surgery. And she's like, yeah, that's cool. Just do that, you know?
Yeah, it's I thought that was strange because I was like, well, because a child died doesn't mean you erase them. Like, okay, well, had four kids. Now I only have three kids. Yeah. And it's like that child is still.
Oh, you mean the dead one. That's right.
Oh yeah, we forgot to tally that one in. Yeah, like I thought that felt really strange to me. So I was like, this has to be an imposter, right? This has to.
And also remember, she came home from the hospital and she said, I need to sleep. I can't, you know, I need a lot of rest. Don't knock if you have to, whatever. And then next day, look, I get that the one time she's eating a snack because he came in, and she didn't want to be bothered or whatever. But then the next day you see her like scrubbing the wall or something, and they're wiping the windows, doing house. I'm like, with the bandages on, and I'm like, what happened to sleeping?
I thought you needed your rest. What is happening?
I think she needed it to maybe, you know, get the current stuff off of her mind, I'm assuming, maybe, possibly.
Just so you guys know, I did some research and I read somewhere, I forget where, maybe been on IMDb, that they didn't give the actors the script. They did like the Gonzo style of like with no script and just kind of strung them along. So maybe there was no script. Maybe they didn't know that. Maybe that's why they sort of contradicted their own premise in certain instances. So I don't know.
I think that they did that in order to keep you confused, because they were very deliberately trying to make you think like, and have the exact same conversation that we're having right now. I believe that was on purpose.
Yeah. Like I wouldn't be surprised if they told the actress who was playing the mom one story and then told the little boys another story.
Yeah.
For not having
you know?
That was pretty good.
Yeah.
I'll give a filmmaker credit for for doing things like that, that get you thinking about things that make you question reality. And we're still talking about it now. So you're right, Heather. Sorry, go ahead, Stina.
Oh, I was going to say, what would you give it as a rating, Keith?
Well, I just want to make one more point, and this is the thing that I think annoyed me the most. No, but there was a really cool scene that ended up being a dream sequence where she went out in the woods and took off her underpants and became some, I don't know, ghost.
She's a ghost or supernatural entity confirmed, you know?
Yeah.
I was, my ears were up. I was like, ooh, I had a chubby going. I'm like, this is going to get good. And then they're like, that was just a dream. We're never going to touch that ever again. And they're like, yeah, you were just right on the cliff of something good and you didn't do it.
That's an alternative they could have had, right? She could have got off the floor, took off the skin, and like, yeah, you caught me, and then just fucking kill him.
This movie also did something very similar to The Midnight Sky, where they had an impressive twist at the end that was compelling, had you emotionally attached to it, and then they sort of undermined it with some really cheap thing, which in this case was a force ghost rather than a Bob's Burgers soft end, you know, where they're just the credits working during the credits scene. So I did respect this movie. I enjoyed watching it. I felt like it was psychological horror. It was a psychological thriller more than horror, but because of all the little, I can't give it more than 3, but I'll give it a solid 3.
Okay. What about you, Stefan?
As far as the ending, I wish they would have had him at the police station and they would have been questioning him and he doesn't answer any of their questions, right? And then kind of like, mm-hmm. like the Norman Bates Psycho thing where the camera kind of goes in and he just looks at, you know, he's looking at them, but we think he's looking at us. And then he, you know, he says, you know, have you guys found my mom yet? Right? Something that identifies the fact that he still, even though with all the shit that happened, that, you know, he doesn't believe that that was his mom, you know. I think that would, and then just kind of end it, or end it where when the hammer is hitting, you know what I mean? Something hard, really hard, and then end it. I think, mm-hmm. yeah, I agree, that would have been better. I'm with Keith. I'd give it three.
Okay. What about you, Heather?
3.5.
3.5?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then that's going to make up for my 2.5. So this is a solid 3 movie. This is probably one of the best rated movies that we've watched so far. It's definitely worth checking out because, I mean, we all found some common ground and there is some artistry in it. Cinematography is beautiful and you'll at least go, what the fuck, and have some squeamish moments.
It's a once over. It's a good once over. Good little, you know, look.
Stina, a 2.5 stars from Stina is a big fuck you to a movie. You see the good in everything. What's that, Heather?
I said this is the opposite of a Stina movie, you know?
Yeah, totally.
And then I still gave it the credit it deserved because you're right. I mean, it definitely deserves the credit. It just, I think the pacing is what got me because it was just a little too slow and I didn't, you know, I didn't pay attention as much as I probably should have or could have. Because I was just like, oh, what are these boys going to do next? Like, okay, I got it. They got the giant hissing cockroaches. They've got this cat. Like, the mom's still being a bitch. I don't know what else to tell you. But, yeah, so this movie gets a solid 3, which is not bad as far as 6 folks of cinema goes.
Get on to Tubi and watch it free.
Yep. And speaking of Tubi, here comes our picks for here comes your guys' choices for next week.
Can I just like hear what the titles are and vote now? Because I gotta dip so soon.
Oh yeah. So we got Housebound, The Taking of Deborah Logan, and Fido.
Okay, I'm doing the first one because I haven't seen it.
Okay. So you're doing Housebound? All right. That's gonna be the first one that we watch. So here we go.
Yo, Your client has been through a number of these treatment programs in the past, and the results have been less than spectacular. Miss Bucknell is in need of stability. I'm therefore ordering an urgent report into the suitability of her mother's house for a sentence of 8 months home detention.
Gosh, that's high tech, isn't it? Aren't you lucky, Kylie, having all that fancy technology on your foot?
Nice to be back home.
Some things have happened since I've been here. Things I can't explain.
There was a ghost in this house, Kylie.
What are you going to do against a hostile spirit?
I'm going to smash it in the face.
Overactive mind in an inactive environment, there's bound to be complications.
I don't need a counseling session. I just need to get out of this house.
Oh, no. They've been doing this all week. Hold on.
The spirit that lives in this house. What is your business here?
So, are you happy to proceed with the story that Mr. McRandall was attacked by a vengeful ghost?
Yes.
Righto.
All right. So, that was the first one. Was that too loud for you guys?
It was a little loud, but it's all right.
There we go. So this is The Taking of Deborah Logan. This is another 2014 movie. That first one was the 2014 movie too.
Okay, I've seen this one. I'm not sure.
73 Apple, take one, Mark.
The story of Alzheimer's is never about one person. My PhD thief. I'm gonna start again.
You wanna keep the house? You need to sacrifice.
You talk to me about sacrifice?
Hey.
Ma!
They want to make a movie about me.
Yes. We will live and document our subject's physical and mental degradation over the course of 2 one-month periods.
We're gonna have fun, right?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I'm not interested in being exploited.
Sarah mentioned that Deb's been sleepwalking pretty bad. So let's set up surveillance cams.
Ma? Deb?
He really gave us all quite a fright with your late night gardening.
This is not normal sleepwalking. You should come see this. It's not good, Doc.
Do you remember a man named Henri Desjardins? Went missing 30 years ago.
I tried to wash you in the river, you know.
A lot can be done.
That woman is crazy.
The notion of spiritual parasites does exist.
Okay.
Movies. And last but not least, the classic Fido.
Good afternoon, boys and girls. So how many of you have ever had to kill a zombie?
Well, not too many.
What would we do without our zombies? They take care of your jobs.
Give me that. This is detail work. Flesh-eating maniacs need not apply.
Do the housework.
Oh, what is that zombie doing in my easy boy?
And play with the kids.
Nice catch,
Fido.
Names are zombie anyway.
Mr. Theopolis has a name for his.
I bet he does.
Nicely done, Tammy.
But for the sake of your neighbors, please keep them fed.
Oh, jeez. That's Mrs. Henderson. We're in trouble, boy.
Ah.
blood on your zombie?
It was a nosebleed.
You stupid zombie!
Help! Is Timmy in trouble?
I like laughing.
Families having to kill their own. I'd take Dee Dee's head off in a second if I had to.
He always says that.
Is that bad?
Yes.
Hold on.
I don't want you thinking what we did is normal or okay in any way.
I don't.
Find out.
So without my job, we'd all be dead. And then where would we be?
Dead.
That's right.
I've seen Fido. Fido's good.
Oh, come on. It's Fido's me. Good. You knew I was going to throw something goofy in there.
Honestly, I like all three options. I feel like they all have something to offer. And Stina, I can't do dirty and pick a move. You know what I mean? Like, I know that I saw your face when Fido was up. I'm going to go with Fido just to do a fun one.
You know, I've seen Fido a million times.
Yeah, but we
love Fido. That's why I was like, we need to give me something. It.
Yeah, so, it'd be fun to see like a fun one. So I'll go with Fido.
So let's see. Heather,
so we've got Housebound and Fido.
I'll do Fido.
Fido?
Yeah, I'm not feeling the other two. That's just me, though. No disrespect.
No worries.
Oh, did you see my selfish choice for New Year's? Yeah.
No, I've seen the Taking of Deborah Logan a long time ago.
Okay.
Yeah, you don't want to watch that.
And she's back.
I came just to say that you don't want to see the Taking of Deborah Logan.
Yes.
But the other two were fine by, like, if I could vote for one not to watch, that's what I would do and just pick that one.
All right. Then we're going to go with the underground classic Fido for next week. Fido. 2006. We love it. And all of these are on Tubi. So if you wanted to watch one of the other ones, they're all on Tubi. They're all free. So
they all have awkward ad breaks.
Tubi.
Oh, yeah.
Sponsor us, baby.
We love you, Tubi.
We love your ad breaks. We'll give you timestamps for every ad break. We'll do your ad break.
You know, if you don't do it, Tubi, we're going to start talking to the ad blocker companies that I use so I don't have to watch your advertisements, and we're going to get a deal with them instead. So just think about it.
Put us in your ads, Tubi.
Exactly. We'll get you out there. All right. So that's our episode, guys. Thanks for checking in and, reviewing Goodnight Mommy with us. You can catch us on social media on Facebook and Instagram at Sick Folks of Cinema. Right? Mm-hmm. Did I get that right?
Sick Folks. Yes. All right. We're
Sick Folks of Cinema.
We're folks on
the clock. Folks in the streets, fucks in the sheets. You know what I'm saying?
Ooh. Heather, don't, whatever you do, don't look behind you. There's a bunch of force ghosts.
All right, guys, we'll see you next Friday. Bye.
See you guys.